Our session is about to begin. The session is titled Fiction, The World Over. Our moderator for this session is Seba Sarwar. Seba is a writer and multidisciplinary artist. Her novel Black Wings was published in 2004, while her videos and installations have been screened in Egypt, India, Pakistan, and the US. She is currently based in Pasadena, California, and is currently working on a variety of projects, including a memoir. Seba, can you introduce again?
Thank you. Welcome, everybody. It's wonderful to see you. It is, the festival is on its way, and the mic is working. Yes, should I speak more in?
Hi.
Really excited to be part of the festival, and this panel is a very special.
इस तरह से
ये पैनल बहुत स्पेशल है. देयर आर सम वंडरफुल राइटर्स ऑन आवर पैनल टुडे एंड द थीम इज फिक्शन द वर्ल्ड ओवर. वी आर गोइंग टू क्रॉस इनटू फिक्शन एंड नॉन फिक्शन एंड सॉर्ट ऑफ टॉक अबाउट द ब्लेंड एंड वी आर वर्किंग ऑफ अ वेरी बेसिक कमेंट दैट वाज मेड अ वेरी इंट्यूटिव कमेंट दैट वाज मेड बाय चिलियन आर्टिस्ट राइटर इसाबेल अयेंदे. She once said, "You can tell the deepest truth with the lies of fiction." And today we will talk about whether the role of a writer is to uncover truth, and then who is the ultimate audience of fiction that is created, or non-fiction for that matter. Can a writer uncover truth and create dialogue across borders and between communities? Fiction, the world over, features writers from India, Kashmir, Italy, France, Pakistan, and the Maldives, who push past political and historic boundaries to generate fiction that uncovers truths that are not often discussed. And afterwards, we will have time for questions. We will have a short readings by each writer that we have today. We will start with Andrea Berini, who is an Italian writer, and he writes creative nonfiction, and he tells stories and writing about people from different countries in Asia, Latin America, and Italy. His work has been translated and published in Southeast Asia. He has also founded and run Metropoli d'Asia, yes, an Italian publishing house that focuses on translating and publishing Asian contemporary fiction. He spends most of his time in Asian cities such as Beijing, Singapore, and Bombay, where he writes about Asian contemporary literature and arts and scouts for his publishing house. Welcome to Karachi and KLF, Andrea.
Thank you, Seba. I've been requested to read. Unfortunately, I will read from Italian.
A little bit.
I am reading from my last book, which is in bookshop in Italy right now. It's a book in which I tell about my meetings with Asian writers in different cities in Asia. Basically, there are five stories, and they are stories of non-fiction. They call it creative nonfiction. I think the reason to use this this expression is that when I write, yes, of course, I write about true facts, something that really happened, but the way I put things on is as the same as I was writing fiction. Now I will write from a chapter in which I tell my meetings with a young writer, Indian writer, Annie Zaidi. And just to introduce her, there is a brief page, one page, about an old Indian writer, Eunice D'Souza. Bombay, lontano inverno del 2007. Vado a trovare Eunice D'Souza, poetessa, mito vivente in città. Ne ho amato una novella, Dangerlock, è la confessione di una donna sola in lotta con i maschi. La protagonista, docente al prestigioso St. Xavier College, percorre la città. Litiga a ragione con ogni tassista furfante, con il conducente del bus sgarbato, con gli impiegati delle poste arroganti e inefficienti, con un padrone di casa vessatorio e con gli idraulici esosi e prepotenti. Maschi indiani, come sempre sulla soglia della violenza fisica davanti a una donna, anche se anziana. Ho un indirizzo, ma il viottolo è stretto, il taxi non ci passa. Faccio a piedi l'ultimo chilometro, la strada è affollata, mi perdo di frequente in una confusione di volti incapaci di darmi una risposta, una direzione coerente, tra braccia che indicano indolenti o sorrisi convinti. Di là, il cellulare di Yunis prende e non prende. Finalmente entro in un palazzo popolare fatiscente, grigiastro. Il cortile è invaso di ciarpame e spazzatura maleodorante, le scale sono anguste, sgangherate, sporche. Su quelle scale e su quelle strade sperimento la fatica di un ceto medio indiano di cui comprendo l'istinto all'autodifesa. Chi ripete che vorrebbe andarsene, chi se ne va davvero, chi impossibilitato a staccarsene costruisce barriere come può, vetri oscurati, pannelli in plexiglass a nascondere la marcescenza dei muri retrostanti. Si mette su una scorza dura, ci si rende irraggiungibili. Mi rivesto anch'io di quella scorza. Più volte ogni giorno siedo dentro a caffè dall'arredamento alla moda in un lindore irreale, poi ne esco, voglio sapere cosa c'è fuori. La stessa De Sousa fu docente di letteratura al St. Xavier College, quello che ha forgiato la sezione più alta del ceto medio di Mumbai, Bombay. Noi preferiamo Bombay, mi dice stanca, seduta su una poltroncina di vimini intrecciati. Mumbai è un falso storico inventato dal fondamentalismo induista e localista. La destra, che ha portato al potere il premier Modi, a Bombay se la prende con gli immigrati da altri stati indiani. Condivide l'appartamento, misero, con un pappagallo che, così raccontano tante foto in bianco e nero degli anni che furono, le stava appollaiato in testa mentre lei componeva le sue poesie. Ho voluto andare a vedere la casa con pappagallo a Santa Cruz e, considerata la fama della poetessa, pensavo di trovare un bel palazzo recente a fianco della via principale con le griffe e le pasticcerie. Due stanze e una gabbia dove è rinchiuso il pappagallo perché non infastidisca l'ospite. Inchiodata a una finestra, una seconda gabbietta con il lato esterno aperto consente a Yunis De Sousa di ricevere visite quotidiane da parte di una gazza che staziona nei dintorni.
Thank you.
5 minutes.
Yes, that was exactly 5 minutes. And you will tell us later on what you read. Or can you just give us a one sentence summary of what you... The... Because we wanted to hear your voice.
Basically, I visit an old poet, a woman, in a peripheral area of Mumbai. And she's very famous, and I get impressed by the fact that she lives in a, let's say, a poor house. In this house, she lives with a parrot, which is her only friend.
Wonderful.
Basically, that's all.
Wonderful. It was wonderful to hear it in your voice. Thank you. We will next hear from Mirza. Mirza Wahid was born and brought up in Kashmir. His debut novel, The Collaborator, was an international bestseller. It was a finalist for the Guardian First Book Award and the Shakti Bhatt Prize, and longlisted for the Desmond Elliott Prize. Wahid's second novel, The Book of Gold Leaves, was a finalist for the 2015 Tata Literature Live Book of the Year. Mirza has written for BBC, The Guardian, Granta, Guernica, Al Jazeera English, and The New York Times.
Thank you. And thank you all for coming. I am going to read two small sections from my second novel, which, as Saiba said, is called The Book of Gold Leaves. Like my first novel, this is also set in Kashmir, in Srinagar, where I grew up, where I was born. It's an amazing, magical city, of course, now brutalized and torn and bruised. There are three main characters, I like to think, in my second novel. There is an artist, and there is the love of his life, called Ruhi, and then there is a shrine. This shrine is a real shrine. There is an actual shrine in the middle of the city called Shah Hamdan Shrine, which has been central to the cultural, political life of the city for at least 400 years. So I'm just going to introduce these characters because we don't have a lot of time. I'll time myself. Fez scratches the paint from his nails. He's an artist. During the day, he paints little papier-mâché boxes, jewelry boxes, pencil boxes that are sold to tourists. That's how he makes his living. But he dreams of becoming a grand painter one day because he's secretly at work on a masterpiece called Falaknuma. But during the day, he makes these little objects that are sold for money. Fez scratches his paint from his nails, not all of it though, as he sometimes feels different, less himself, if he does not see his hands flecked with the colors he has worked with during the day, and tries to decide whether he should go to the mosque or to the shrine first. He turns on the radio to listen to All India Radio's Urdu service, which plays the best music for evenings such as these, the finest ghazals he can find on any radio station. He turns to his creations, the floor full of them. Finished, semi-finished, and just begun pieces spread all around him. The half-done pencil boxes present hills and jungles in formation, and animals in chase with no quarry in sight. A tiger sparkles golden hair, and a deer cranes its neck against the blue of the sky. A lion reclines, its eyes red with passion, and the end of its tail a fine blonde goblet. Fez's signature style and a would-be master's sign, Rangrez, the old paint seller says. Only one box is fully finished and varnished. Fez did it at the beginning as a sample for Pierre, who wants all the boxes to look exactly like this one. That is always a specification, Fez knows. And that is why he always keeps the master artifact in front of him. But he can never quite bring himself to produce exact replicas, even though he's capable of it. He will always add a little something to each piece, a tiny nightingale that peeks out of a corner bush, a gazelle darting across the border, a kingfisher's reflection in a talker's pool, a Persian couplet intertwined with a forest wine. The only time he does not do it is when, towards the end of a job, he starts to worry he has been away too long from his secret personal work in progress, Falaknuma, the biggest canvas he has ever embarked upon, his life's work. His eyes stop on a small screen he had finished just before the pencil boxes arrived. It's a copy of the painting Mustafa Pir had allowed him to trace with pencil in his presence, taking the original back with him when Fez was done. In the center of the screen, the Persian poet Umar Khayyam, leaning against ornate cushions on a narrow boat, is holding a papier-mâché cup into which a woman with the most beautiful hair Fez has ever seen is pouring wine from a long curd flask. The flow of the wine, by design it seems, reflects the woman's tresses. The river the boat is floating along, there is no boatman, is a pale blue, revealing dark weeds, water plants, and golden fish. Tall grasses grow on either side of the river, and the world outside is not visible except for the blue-black sky that has no moon but a multitude of stars. Fez remembers painting each of them, each star, with great care, washing his brush for every new star. He turns back to the center of the screen and remembers the cup. Was the painting on the cup a miniature replica of the main painting? Khayyam is again holding a cup as the woman with the dark hair pours wine into it. In the original too, the evening is beginning to slip into night. Fez switches off the radio and heads out. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next reader is Ibrahim Wahid Aguru. He lives in the Maldives, where he is known for his work as a multi-skilled educator, public speaker, published author, and television personality. For more than 30 years, he served his country's government in various capacities, including Director General, Ministry of Information, Arts and Culture, Commissioner of Elections, and more, before retiring in 2013. An active television writer, Wahid has his own television program, Witness with Wahid. He writes regularly for magazines and other publications. both locally and overseas.
Thank you, ma'am. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, ladies and gentlemen. And thank you so much for welcoming me to Karachi. And I thought it was all going to be strange faces. Sitting on my right, there's a gentleman with whom I share a name, and sitting right over there is somebody I've known for 7 years, another writer, Nayara Rahman. Thank you for coming in. So I'll share with you a little short story which comes from the Maldives. Some of you might be familiar with that little country sitting in the middle of the Indian Ocean, some of you might not. But it really doesn't matter. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the life of a young lady. This story is from about 10 years ago, and it has won a few awards. Let me just share this with you. A rumble in the west. A cold breeze blows past my face. A thin streak of lightning drawn like a pencil line of fire in the distant sky. Shop lights shine in my eyes and then go out, one after the other, as sales girls settle the cash registers and lock up. Some notice the possibility of a tropical downpour and hurriedly call their boyfriends to come and scooter whiz them home. I envy them, for my work is only starting. Like hidden balls of dark cotton wool drawn over the face of a faded moon, dark clouds come crawling over the night sky. Expectations of a quick coffee at the friend's favorite gossip point are dashed, as all young working people are now forced to seek better shelter. After all, when the rain starts, you have no idea when it will stop. Some take to quietly cursing the inconvenience. But I love a rainy night, even though my work is only beginning. People have nothing but excuses called reasons to avoid going out on a rainy night. I have none. I have to be out there earning a living. As for those who have those excuses, their entire argument is based on things like likes and dislikes. Likes and dislikes, you ask? I'm sure you don't like getting your clean new clothes wet on a rainy night. I'm sure no one likes getting splashed in the road, especially when it is cold and dark. When powerful tourist resort owners rush by in their last year model BMWs, they don't really care if they splash you or not, do they? I'm sure you don't like the cold dripping, deeply depressing, inner soul ripping gloom of a rainy night, especially after a thunder shower. I'm sure you don't like stepping into those unseen water-filled gaps left in the sidewalk by the cable TV guys. And usually there is no one to pick you up if you step into one. You're lucky if you have one, aren't you? So no one goes out walking on a rainy night, but I love a rainy night. In the cooling drizzle of a rainy night, I can hide the warm tears that sometimes flow down my cheeks when I feel the reality of my life. When it rains, I can have a peaceful, free moment all to myself, free to rest and think of my sad, sad soul. In a night shower, I can savor the light, cold sprinkling of pure water from God's own skies caressing my face. It feels 1,000 times better than the rough hands of a half drunk. And if it rains all night and I get to see the morning sun finally coming up to comfort a weeping sky, I give thanks then for having been saved from one more night of indignity. At the end of a rainy night, it is heaven to taste the last of the rain on my smiling lips. And a genuine smile is a rare luxury for me. I call it heaven because God's rare mercy as such comes to a cheap soul like mine rarely, very rarely. I love a rainy night because it sometimes stops my owner from selling me by the hour for the steep price and the street price of two pieces, one for him, one for me. The story is called I Love a Rainy Night.
Thank you.
So, you know what that is about. And two of those problems, that kind of work and that kind of peace, two very real problems where I come from. And I don't know whether the people who do it, the customers or people who stand by and watch, who is to blame. Anyways, I think finished my little story and helped you with the time, madam. And I'll take your leave here and thank you once again for your attention. Assalamu alaikum.
Well, we'll hear more from you in a bit. To my left, Beena Shah, author and writer of English fiction, and she's a journalist, as many of you know, living in Karachi. She is the author of 4 novels, 2 collections of short stories, including Slum Child, which was a bestseller in Italy, a regular contributor to the International New York Times. She is a provocative and bold commentator for the international press on Pakistan society, culture, and women's rights. Her most recent novel, A Season for Martyrs, was published in France, India, and India last year. In her spare time, she fights with trolls on Twitter. There's a lot of them right now.
Yeah, not here though, I hope. Thank you for the introduction, which I wrote myself anyway. So I am delighted to be here on this panel talking about fiction and the world. It's very interesting what we do as writers. There are 2 things that I love to do. One is to travel to different parts of the world, and the other is to meet writers from different parts of the world. And in this way, we as writers collect worlds. In fact, that's the name of a novel to whose author I'm going to be speaking to tomorrow, a German writer who's written a book called The Collector of Worlds. And when I was thinking about this panel, I thought this is exactly what we do as writers. We collect worlds and then we write about them. So in the spirit of that idea that our work is a collection of the worlds that we travel through and the worlds that we meet, the worlds that come to us and the worlds that we go to, I'm going to read a short extract from a short story that I wrote, which has been published last year in a US journal. It's called The Living Museum. This is a very weird museum. It's in Rome, but what's inside the museum hasn't got a lot to do with Rome or the Romans. The museum hadn't looked big enough to accommodate a gallery of this size. It was 50 feet long, as deep as it was wide. The walls were full-length photographs of a souk in a Middle Eastern country, a myriad of different-sized stalls pushed up against each other, colorful cloth, brass wares, and piles of spice and dry fruit heaped all over the tables. Above, red canopies shielded them from a hot midday sun, and doves fluttered from the orange trees to the wooden pillars keeping the canopies upright. Her ears were filled with the muted murmurs of a busy market crowd, the sounds of a lute or a mandolin playing a pentatonic melody, the shouts of children playing nearby. Allegra looked around for signs or instructions, but all she could see was a long table fit for a banquet hall at the far end of the room. Paolo, marching past Allegra when they'd entered, was already examining its contents. "Hey," he called back to them, "there's food here, come and see." Allegra and the others joined him to peer curiously at the tabletop. Small red bowls contained different preparations, creamy dips topped with drizzles of oil, a brown mashed paste decorated with onions and sliced tomatoes, a basket with triangles of flatbread. I can't read with this music going on. What is this? Can we have the doors closed?
Yes.
I'm sorry.
It's
the wrong music. It's the wrong country.
It doesn't quite. It's better.
Where is it? It's
on the main stage.
Oh my God.
It's on the main stage.
All right. I'm sorry about this. I really just can't do this with that going on.
And we can't hear you through the music, actually.
Okay. Can we have the doors shut, please?
How's that?
Huh.
Ah.
I'm just going to stop, you know. I can't do this. Would you like to come and try doing this?
All right, Bina.
What is all this? Said the German woman. Allegra gazed at the pretty bowls and dishes, recognizing them from the days she'd spent in Morocco. It's Arabic breakfast. Look, za'atar wa zayt, spices and olive oil. You eat it with the pita bread there. And that's hummus, and those are scrambled eggs. And labne, it's like yogurt, but better. Oh, and ful. Ful? Asked the Italian woman with the silver hair. No, ful, fava beans. And look, that's knefe. It's so delicious. Oh, I wonder if we're meant to eat it. As they stood there staring, music began to play, a woman's throaty croon filling their ears. She was singing a song about Beirut, as far as Allegra could tell. It was the only word she recognized. A dark-eyed, full-cheeked woman's face appeared on the wall to the left of the table. Fairuz, a caption read underneath, Songstress of the Arab World. Allegra clapped her hands in time to the beat, laughing. She had never forgotten the first time she'd eaten these foods, the bursts of sumac and cinnamon and sesame on her tongue, the tang of hummus, the freshness of the bread, and the woody mystery of the olive oil. Her mouth was already watering with memory and anticipation. This food to her was love. Love of that beautiful boy with the tanned skin and dark eyes, whose arms had enfolded her and whose kisses had tasted of cigarette smoke and lemons. Thank you.
Thank you, Vina. Beautiful.
And we will close this part of the reading, of this reading with Paul Verret. Yes. He's a senior lecturer at the Bordeaux-Montaigne University, has published a range of writings and publications, including Le Lef, IU, FM de Paris, Paris, number 4, ABC, pre and post publication itineraries of the contemporary novel in English, and much more. And Paul, you won't be reading, you'll be talking more, is that the plan?
Yes, since I'm not a novelist. Unfortunately, at least in this life. So first, thank you very much for having me on this panel. This is my first time in Karachi, my first time in Pakistan.
Oh, and, welcome.
So yes, thank you very much. This is, I'm extremely thrilled to be here, especially now, especially with what is going on in contemporary fiction, and especially in contemporary Pakistani fiction. So when I first received this invitation, Fiction the World Over, that made me come to think about a couple of things, and I've jotted down a few ideas, maybe to keep the ball rolling and to wrap up to from what has been from what we've heard. So this idea of fiction the world over, of course, makes us think about the idea of global fiction, of contemporary global fiction, and the how does contemporary fiction, contemporary South Asian fiction, react to the, I would say, the illusions and disillusionment about globalization. So that's the first thing, and the second point I would say is how does a literature become world literature? In other words, how does a writer who lives in a certain determined historical, social, linguistic time and place, how does he become global? How does he address other readers from other cultures, other languages? In other words, how did Jóknapa Tófa from Faulkner's imagination become something that's been able to catch the imagination of authors worldwide? The same thing with Homer Simpson, of course, but also Homer from Homer from the Iliad and the Odyssey. After all, the Odyssey is about a very unlucky Greek mercenary coming home, or maybe not wanting to come home to his aging wife. Or is it a tragedy about the human condition, and so on and so forth? In other words, how does a, that's the big question, how does a such a novelist become, well, attracted and attracts other readers? So that's the big question. It's something that I've been thinking about. For example, now through reading, I've never been to Clifton Beach or French Beach, but I know these places. Just like I know what Dublin is like after reading Ulysses. So that's the perhaps the one of the great things of language, and perhaps the English language. So more specifically, I would say that South Asian, Indian and Pakistani fiction particularly answer that question, because all the, I would say, the most important publications, the most important fictions were precisely about that, about border crossing, and about precisely crossing these borders. So first, of course, the fundamental questions about Pakistani fiction are about the questions around the partition of the Indian subcontinent. And of course, with the history of Pakistan, the history of India and Pakistan, that's been very often repeated in stories, fictions and novels. And the turning point certainly was the 1980s and the 1980s, with precisely when that question of globalization, when these post-colonial questions became right at the heart of literary productions. And what is fascinating now, what I found extremely thrilling and exciting now, is to see how this new generation, the 2000s millennial novelists perhaps, also tackle that question of globalization. The possibility of traveling other places, but also the disillusionment that come with the limits of globalization. The rise of the question of reading, seeing, perceiving the other as a very suspicious character. I'm thinking, of course, the great confrontational theories that grew in the 80s and 90s in America concerning the vision of the world, and especially the vision of the Muslim world, where the other is the Oriental other, the very dangerous, subversive terrorist, of course. So this new generation, these millennial Pakistani writers, have come with great literary answers. I'm thinking here, with Mohsin Hamid's The Reluctant Fundamentalist, who raises these questions with that character. I'm sure you you know him, young man who has been educated in America, and then one day he's become extremely suspicious because he, after 9/11, he lets his beard grow, and he and his friends and colleagues sort of look him askance like this. So I think this is the big issue now. These frontiers, which we think melted away, disappeared in the 90s, now have are all over the place. And I think it's the duty, or perhaps the power of fiction writers to question, deconstruct these borders, and provide well, aesthetic and political answers to them. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you, Paul. So in many ways, you've sort of put together what everybody talked about. We've had work from Bombay, from Kashmir, from the Maldives, from Rome / Pakistan / Lebanon. And I think that when we were talking about, when this panel was created, we were talking about what is the role of fiction? Does a writer have the obligation to present this view and to create a new reality, to share a reality, or does a writer create work just for the imagination? And over here we have writers who have chosen different, some similar paths, but some different. And it would be very interesting to have each of you talk about, to respond to that question, what is the role of the writer? Is the role of the writer to himself, herself, or is it to a larger audience and to make change in some way? Because as we began with, Isabel Allende said, you can tell the deepest truths with the lies of fiction. Is that what we are supposed to do with fiction? Or non-fiction for that matter? Do we want to just take the questions going through?
Well, I now remember a sentence by J.G. Ballard about that. Mm-hmm. It's in my memory. I'm not quoting, of course. But more or less he used to say, and it was possibly 30 years ago, he used to say, this is a world which is plenty of narrations, publicity, marketing, television, politics has its narrative, and we are plenty of images. So what should the writer do? And his answer is, a writer must invent reality. And what I think is exactly that. I am a non-fiction writer, and I was thinking to what I write now. I write about another writer in India. Okay, what should I focus? In the language and the vocabulary used by that writer, and in the choice that he or she puts in her novels, or in her life and in understanding what is behind the need for him or for her to start being a novelist. And I choose this third option. Well, somehow I am inventing a new reality, because I don't tell the truth, the complete truth of this writer, about this writer. I tell part of the truth. And this question, which is what is truth, is more and more relevant now. J.G. Ballard is a science fiction writer, so he can predict the future. Possibly he neither knew about the internet. Now the internet gives us such a flow of different pieces of information. And being a writer is deciding which piece of information to choose to build up a narration. Mm-hmm. So to build up a new reality. End of the story, when you write, what is in your book is absolutely your point of view on a certain reality. Mm-hmm. And you have to be honest, in my opinion, mm-hmm. and put in your book this, to allow the reader to understand that what you write is your point of view and there are other point of views.
Right, and as we write, what is the difference then between what you read on the internet, as you pointed out, and what is the difference between a book where you open the pages and you turn the pages and you get caught up and you enter into this life, whether it is non-fiction, creative non-fiction, or fiction. And Mirza, you're writing from a very volatile place, and there's almost an obligation that comes with where you're from to tell that story. And what if you choose not to tell that story and to do something different? What happens with that question for you about the role of a writer, especially a writer sharing from Kashmir?
A writer from a difficult place, as we call it sometimes. I don't think it's an obligation as such. I mean, there's
a lot. Can you speak into the mic?
Oh, I'm so sorry. I don't think a fiction writer or novelist sits on his desk and decides that I'm going to write a novel. I have a manifesto here and I'm going to now write a novel according to that manifesto. But I agree, you ask questions. especially if you come from a difficult place, the choice doesn't exist. You know, Aminata Forna, this fantastic novelist, once said about she grew up at a time of civil war. She didn't have a choice. How could she not write about the most important thing that happened in her lifetime to her family, to her people, and pretend it didn't happen? Mm-hmm. So the choice doesn't exist. It's also, I mean, the question has become fraught recently. You know, does a writer become political? Does he have obligations? Does he represent? Does he portray? So on and so forth. Back in the day, Latin American writing fiction was deeply, deeply political. Mm-hmm. And they did not pause to think, do I write a political novel or not? The question doesn't arise. They write a novel, and it happens to be political because that's what they live and experience and grow up into. For me personally, I think the closest I come to answering that question is, have I put the question there? Have I asked the questions that have been bothering me? Have I put in things in my novel that agitate me? And I do like to think of fiction as something that upsets me. I like fiction. I like to read fiction that agitates me, makes me angry or upset, stirs something in me. But that said, I don't think, I mean, we write stories. And as Andrea said, he mentioned J.G. Ballard. Ballard wrote a fantastic book called Kingdom Come 20 years ago, 30 years ago. And it's all come true. He predicted our reality TV culture. He predicted our media frenzies that we witness every night. We just witnessed one when we had Lata Mangeshkar intervene while we were talking. So those questions come, they become part of the writing itself. I don't, as I said in the beginning, I don't think a fiction writer sits at night and says, I am going to take on this country or that state or that problem, and then writes fiction according to that. The story is paramount, the narrative is paramount. And if in the process you ask big questions, absolutely.
And that is what your choice has been, because of where you are.
Yes, I mean, for me, for instance, we grew up watching a lot of Bollywood representation of Kashmir, which was essentially rubbish, because you saw Kashmiris as these boatmen or people who rode horses for Shami Kapoor and Sharmila Tagore and all those people. And when you grow up and you say, okay, that's not really it. You know, there is more to Kashmir than the houseboat and the beautiful Shikara on the Dal Lake. And especially when you grow up at a time of great war and conflict and brutality, I wrote my first novel, for instance, in the winter of 2007 or 6, and I did not have the choice of writing about the lakes and rivers and the beauty of Kashmir, because I had grown up with enormous violence, not just around me, but by my doorstep, outside our kitchen window. Everyone was affected. So if you grow up with that kind of, and you have a sensibility, you have delusions of becoming a writer, you think, you know, you have stories to tell, that is exactly what you're going to write about.
Mm. That makes sense. Thank you. Wahid?
Wahid. Which one?
Did you have any comments? I mean, because you're writing from the Maldives, and if you go to the other side of the world, people are probably like, where are the Maldives? We know the Maldives, obviously, in South Asia. But what obligation comes upon you when you create work?
Let me put an entirely different spin on that. I mean, first of all, I never chose to be a writer. I'm the kind of guy that wakes up at 3 o'clock in the morning, and unless, you know, I spill on the paper everything I feel, I just can't go back to sleep. And that's how I write. But let me put an entirely different spin on this entire ball game. It goes like this. Let's consider this. Let's go slightly scientific on this. I mean, a lot of animals, when they're born, they're kind of hard programmed to do the things that they do. Snake hatches out of the egg. It's already got poison in it, knows how to hunt. And a human baby doesn't. A human baby's got to be taught. So a lot of the material that you need to survive out there simply doesn't exist, hard programmed into the human brain. So where does this knowledge reside? Outside. Right? That repository of knowledge Call it literature, call it experience, call it folklore, call it anything. It is outside. And language and the repository of language, call it literature, held in any form, forms a great part of that. And that perhaps is why we as writers can sometimes hold ourselves responsible for what happens in society. And I think it's also our duty as human beings, it doesn't matter whether you call yourself a writer or not, I think every single one of us is, that maybe it'll be a very good idea, and damn good idea, excuse my French, that we should leave to our great-great-grandkids what we felt, what we saw, what we experienced with our 5+ senses. Maybe it's our duty to do so. At least let future generations feel what we felt. Maybe they feel something different. We don't know. Let life go on. But perhaps this is part of the great blessing that we have, which we call life. You know, as most of you are Muslim, which of God's blessings do you deny? Should we? فَبِأَيَّ أَلَىٰ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. Do we? Well, we shouldn't. So I take that spin with me. And thank you so much again. I mean, I'm seriously sitting here humbled. I thought myself an entire stranger when I came here. There is somebody on my right sharing my name. And let me share this with you, sir. My great-grandmother happens to be Kashmiri.
Lovely to meet you.
And somebody just mentioned Lebanon. Well, I spent 6 years of my life there. Have you had a home in Lebanon?
No.
Okay, so here we go. So it's a small world after all. You know, it's a very, very small world. So let's, you know, enjoy this. Let's try and get this thing over with. I mean, writers and non-writers, there's no such thing. Every single human being is a writer, whether you want to write it and put it out there on paper or whether you want to write it for yourself, within yourself, that's up to you to decide. My very humble suggestion to you is put a little bit of it out there. Just try it out. For those of you who are interested, go to www.ogaru.org. So ogaru.org, and you'll see what I mean.
Writing that you're producing. Thank you. Veena, comments? I mean, you're writing a range of work from Karachi, Rome. What is the role? Where does it stop? Where does it start?
Schizophrenia? I don't know. No, okay, so I'm very literal-minded. So when you ask me a question like, what is the role of the writer, I immediately start writing. Mm-hmm. I start writing the answer to the question. I think...
So what did you write?
All right, I'll tell you. The role of the writer is to tell stories. And I almost feel like we romanticize the writer so much, and we forget about the story. Mm-hmm. But that's what I'm here to do, is to tell stories. We tell stories to our children from almost the day they're born. We tell them the story of the day they were born, right? Your kid wants to know, how was I born? How did I get here? Why am I here? Blah, 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 blah. You make up a story. You can't tell your child, well, you were born and you came from whatever, and one day you'll die. You don't want to tell your kid that. So you start inventing stories, how to explain that. Maybe you look to religion. Maybe you look to science, or you look to your own invention. So stories really start as the building blocks of our psychology and of our societies. I, as a writer, you know, you can say, why did I become a writer? Oh, because I had so much to say. I want to express myself. I want to put my wonderful ideas out there and share them with the world. This is ego, pure ego. Everybody has stories to tell, and everybody's story is as important as the next person. This is when Waheed the Maldivian says that, you know, we're all a storyteller. You anoint us with the title of writer, and suddenly we seem much more magical and much more mystical than the rest of you, but each one of us is telling stories from the beginning. So you start out as a young writer with this very egotistical idea that you're going to reveal a genius personality to the world. Look, my thoughts are so unique. Nobody could possibly have had this. Yes, they have. And you were, you know, so that's your ego. Once you get that out of the way with like your first three books and you realize they're all awful, and then you realize that your true role as the writer is what Ian Foster said, only connect. You're only trying to connect. You're trying to connect to your readers. You're trying to connect your readers to you. You're connecting your readers to each other. And you're connecting readers to worlds and worlds to worlds and stories to stories. You are the spider that's spinning the web. I'm really glad you brought your kid here. It's really good to see that. I'm happy, even though she doesn't sound very happy. The writer's loyalty is to the story, and the writer is the conduit for the story. The story itself is what we should be focusing on. The writer is the barometer, but the story itself is the atmosphere. And the stories are, as Mirza II again said, they are what we will leave our future generations. The stories are the archives of our societies and of our psychology, what was important to us, what we found to be truthful at the time of our lives. So I think that my job is just to do that.
Yes, you're right. Yeah.
Thank you.
Since you spoke earlier, is it okay if we open it out to the audience, Paul? Do you have a quick summary?
Okay, so I see that the...
We only have about 5 minutes.
Yeah. I'll be quick. I see how we've moved on from rather high considerations to this idea of storytelling. Yes, indeed, we are storytelling animals. We are social creatures, and therefore we tell stories. We need narratives, not just to tell ourselves stories, but generally we need to tell. Each other's, we need fiction. That's maybe one of the things that makes us different from animals. And also, we have to accept that, for example, it's clear in literature and fiction that there's, from one point of view, there's nothing really original about stories. Everything has already been said. In other words, I love you is the world's most quoted sentence. That's it, really. And I think we need that mastery of language. Some are more at ease than others. I'm not sure that everyone has a story to tell. Thank God. There'd be millions and millions of books to write and to read, but some are more gifted than others. So yes, that would be my own personal conclusion. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anybody have any questions? I'm sure there's a lot to talk about.
Specifically, Paul had something to say that was of higher considerations, you know, something beyond storytelling.
Uh-huh.
I want to touch on that. I mean, it could seem a little off the track, but the world literature, the whole thing about world literature, I basically want to do a MPhil here in Pakistan. My teacher said, look, we're done with post-colonial, all right? We are moving into world literature, all right? Great. And I said, I want to do Derek Walcott. Because I'm like, really, I love his poetry. I mean, he's amazing. Mm-hmm. And he said, why Derek Walcott? How does he relate to Pakistan?
Yeah.
Big question. You're an academic. I really, you know, want to bring this up. How does he relate to Pakistan? The question is about world literature, that we're basically the world over, we're basically looking at literature. A Pakistani guy in a Pakistani university wants to investigate Derek Walcott. His mentor, you know, prospective mentor, advisor basically tells him that how does he relate to Pakistan? Does he really need to relate to Pakistan? Is there such a thing as, you know, Walcott basically goes, picks up, you know, carries on the Homer theme. Now, do we look for Homerian kind of...
So the question, just because of the shortage of time, the question is, should we limit ourselves to work that is exclusively from our region?
It's an open...
It's an open question.
I basically want an answer, that's all.
Okay.
All right. World literature, you know, bringing in Derek Walcott to Pakistan. Why? Do we need to bring Derek, can't we study Derek Walcott for what he is?
We have some other people with questions, so let's see if we can take another question and then we'll come back to that.
Okay. Yeah.
There's a question over there.
There's many questions and we have to wrap up, so.
There's a question over there.
Well, if you can pose it as a short question, that would be great, and then we'll answer the two.
It will be very short. I heard Andrea saying that the writer should invent the reality. That's a little confusing. How would you differentiate it from exploring the reality? How could one actually invent it? Because realities are already there, and as we heard that there is nothing new, everything has been said. We have to just explore it and find it out.
Okay. So anybody, any one of you can take those questions, but since that was posed to you.
Everybody explore reality. I mean, the basic of our writing, of our job is seeing outside, what is outside us. And there is a wish, there is a desire by the writer to understand something in the world which is around himself. But in my opinion, Ballard is right when he say he's inventing reality. Because anyway, when I start writing about something that I have seen, and it is non-fiction, it is not fiction, I put my fiction in it. I have stories in my head. I have something else that is coming. And what they call creative non-fiction is possibly exactly that. The meeting between my stories, the stories that I have in my head, and the story that I find in the real world. In this way, I can say that I invent reality. I invent something new.
Thank you. And Paul, and anybody else, and people who are leaving, please feel free to. We're going to take just a couple of minutes to wrap this up.
The first question, Derek Walcott and Pakistani literature. Yes, of course. Derek Walcott is because he has reinvented. He's not just a Caribbean writer. He's a you can find. Greek mythology, all the great world narratives in his writing, and of course he relates to a Pakistani reader, or when it comes to that, I don't know, English reader, Italian, and I don't think there's readers have nationalities at some point.
I love that readers don't have nationalities.
It's the same framework where Fez relates to people in England or Russia. Would you ask the same question of why is Fez relevant to readers of Fez's work in America, in England, or Russia? He's a poet. He appeals to everyone.
Oh, why do we all read Shakespeare? He's British. He's keep him in the borders.
I said in a previous panel that truth has no nationality, and truth has no borders. And the great writers and the great artists of this world are tapping into truths that are universal. And so I would find something to relate in Shakespeare as a Pakistani. I would find something to relate to Margaret Atwood as a Pakistani. Any great writer is going to say things that are true, and that translates across any language or culture. You should ask yourself, what is it that you like about Derek Walcott?
So what we will do is we don't have time. We're going to get pushed off the stage because people are coming in. But we can move off to the side and we can chat. Thank you so much, each and every one of you. You've said wonderful.
I'll use one sentence.
If you want to.
Thank you.
Thank you.
One last remark to the gentleman about invention of reality is this one. Have you considered this possibility that every time you read a history book, you're actually reading fiction?
That's another great comment to end with. Thank you.